happen someday. But you know, when we first started the church 28 years ago, the phrase God gave us was changing lives through the application of God's anointed word. And what God meant about that was we were supposed to present the word, teach the word, preach the word, and you're supposed to get a hold of it and allow God to change your life so that you get over all of the junk that you went through as a kid, get over all the mental stuff and the physical stuff, get you healed, set free, delivered in every way. And Justin has done that. And he was baptized in the first service, and it's just a privilege. I'll miss you while you're gone, but you'll come back, I'm sure. Amen. So we're having our water baptism service, and the water baptism should be the beginning of a changed life. You know, God never decided, you know, God, how many know God likes you? Poke your neighbor and say, God likes you. Just poke him. Say, God likes you. Poke your neighbor, say, God likes you. Poke him again, say, but he likes me better. Because you need to realize, if you have any relationship with God, that God likes you. Amen. And if you're like me, when he found me, he liked me, but he didn't necessarily like me the way I was. And thank God for the Word and the Holy Ghost. He got me changed and helped me somewhat. Amen. But the whole idea of coming to Christ is to get a new life and to be changed, and then to honor God with that life and not just continue living the way you live and living with the depression. And anybody ever watch TV at night? I have once or twice, and all you see are commercials about depression. I'm like, all these people that are watching TV are depressed. Well, I can understand that. But I mean, that's the thing of the world now. Everybody needs medication for something. But thank God, with God, he's our medicine. Amen. The word is our medicine. And God is always good to us. And so for the water baptism this morning, how many are getting baptized this morning? Show me your hands. All right. Praise God. So you're all over there. Good deal. So let me start with Mark chapter 16, verse 16. We're going to talk about water baptism a little bit. And a little bit about changed life, because how many of you are here to watch somebody get baptized? That's the only reason you came. Okay, now put them down. Did they make you come? Raise your hand if they made you come to get water. Okay. So you came on your own to watch them? All right. Praise God. All right, so Mark 16, verse 16. I don't know about you, but when I accepted Christ, it made a big difference in my life. I got saved, really saved, when I was 32. And I spent the first 32 years of my life being just about as stupid as you could get. In fact, I just went to my 50th high school reunion on Friday, and I thought I was at the senior center. I was like, whoa, did I get the wrong class? But when I got saved, God changed me. But he doesn't do it against your will. He demands your cooperation. And the way he was able to change me was because I cooperated with his word, and I wanted him, and I wanted to be changed. And he did a lot of work, but it took a lot of work on my part too. And I make that point because just because you got saved and you're getting water baptized doesn't mean, well, now I just come and sit in church on the weekends and everything's okay. No, this is the beginning of you doing something for Christ and you loving God with all your heart forever and changing whatever needs to be changed. Whatever he says needs to be changed, you just say, yes, Lord, help me, and then go after it. Amen. Because he has a plan for our lives. Every one of you in here that's born again, he has a plan for your life, and it's not to go to work and go home and watch TV. It's to reach people for Christ. And not to talk ill of anybody, because I'm not talking ill about anybody, but at the reunion, you know, most of these people I knew them when I was in high school, and a lot of them are retired now, been retired for 6, 7, 8 years, and they've stayed in the same place. They retired, and now they're just retired. And I don't know about you, but I want to change people's lives. I want to help people know God, know the blessings of God, the goodness of God. I want people to be introduced because, you know, after watching people for 30-some years, actually 68 years, most people that I see spend most of their life trying to get over what happened to them the first 8 years of their life. They were told they were stupid, they're not bright, they're ugly, they're made fun of. How many, you ever been in school, grade school? I mean, grade school kids are like the worst. They're worse than a barking dog. I mean, if you have a wart, they'll figure out how to make you feel bad about it for the rest of your life. And most of us hear that stuff, and then it affects us. And so I watch people, and they spend the whole rest of their life trying to get over how bad they grew up feeling. And God can take care of that, because a psychiatrist can't. I went to college, and most of the people taking psychiatry to become psychiatrists were taking it to find out what was wrong with them. And so I don't know if they ever did or not, but only Christ, only the Holy Ghost can help you get over who you used to be or who you don't like anymore and help you become a new creation in Christ. And so Mark 16, verse 16, it starts out, he says, "He who believes." And for me, believing is not just saying, yeah, okay, and then sitting on your rump. Believing is doing something and acting. It's not just, you know, faith produces an action. If you say, I have faith, but you don't do anything, you don't have faith, because faith always produces an action. And if you say, I believe in Christ, then you got to live for him. You can't say, I believe in Christ, I hope he doesn't bother me anymore, though. That's not, no. I believe in Christ, and I want him to mess with my life. I want him to find out whatever I need to change so that people can accept from me what I've got from him. Amen. And he says, he who believes and is baptized will be saved, but he who does not believe will be condemned. And this is in here because everybody on the earth is going to hell unless they receive Christ. Amen. It's not that the evil people are going to hell. Everybody without Christ is going to hell. Our job is to let those know that there's another plan, and if you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you can get put into another family and you don't have to go to hell. It's not about, well, yeah, they're bad, they deserve to go to hell. No, they're in the same boat you were. And somebody needs to tell them so that their life can be changed, so that they can receive Jesus as their personal Lord and Savior and begin to obey him and obey the word and get a life that's worth living. I don't know about you, but the life I was living in high school wasn't worth living. But it was like everybody else's life. And thank God that God was able to locate me, find me, and get my heart turned to him. And we've been preaching for 30 years and been all over the country and all over the world preaching the word of God, getting people healed. And God did that to an idiot. That's powerful. Because God doesn't want any of us wasting our life. He doesn't want us wasting, oh, I got to get a job, I got to get a car. Forget that. Find Jesus, and then whatever you need will come. Serve Jesus with all your heart, and you won't have to worry about it. You can go to the store and buy food. Go to the restaurant and have people give your kids money. Now watch this. It says, he who believes and is baptized will be saved, but he who does not believe will be condemned. Watch verse 17. And I mean, there is such a transition. 1 second they're believing, and then it says, and then these signs will follow those who believe. Evidently, believers are supposed to be doing something that the signs and wonders can follow, rather than just sitting around in church. He says, and these signs will follow those who believe. In my name, they will cast out demons. Uh-oh. They will speak with new tongues. They will take up serpents. And if they drink anything deadly, it will by no means hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick, and they will recover. That's what the Bible says the Christians who believe are supposed to be doing. Y'all over there. From this day forward, you're not normal anymore. from today on, you're called, anointed, and appointed by God to do something. And he's got a plan for you. And you might be saying, well, I'm not up to it. I've always made the wrong mistakes. That's all going to change. Amen. You give in to God, God is going to supply you. He's going to fix you. And you're going to be able to do anything he says to do. Amen. Amen. This isn't the end. This is the beginning.
Amen.
Amen. When God looks at you right now, he's excited. Because he's got 7 volunteers for kingdom work. 7 people who are saying, man, I want to serve God with all my heart. And I'm not just going to be a pew sitter. Man, I'm going to go touch the world, cast out demons. Lay hands on the sick, watch them recover. Can I just tell you something? If you come to this church, you know, we pray for people to get healed quite often. But my desire is that you learn how to get your own healing. My desire is you learn how to get receive your own promises through the Word of God. You learn how to stand on the Word of God for yourself. My desire is every man here that has a family, that you are the spiritual head of your family. And when something comes, the devil tries to attack your home, you stand up and tell him no. When division starts to enter your family, you fix it. That when sickness tries to come in or whatever tries to come in your family, you just don't allow it. As a godly man, as a spiritual head of the household, you take your place. And you let the devil know, no, you're not coming in and messing with my house. Our house, when we first got born again and filled with the Holy Spirit, and because we loved God so much. I mean, God told us through a woman. She was preaching about putting God first and keeping other junk, and he had us take everything in our house that didn't honor him to the dump. I took 2 pickup loads of our stuff to the dump. Dave Brubeck albums. And I think back now, and I think, well, that might have been just a little crazy. But God so honored that decision that, Lord, if I think something in my house doesn't honor you, it's leaving. He so honored that people would come over to our house and wouldn't leave because of the peace of God in our home. I'd much rather have that than Dave Brubeck. Y'all out there? God wants your life, your near home, to be a place where when people come around you, come around your home, they sense the presence of God and they want to know what's going on here. Y'all out there? When we got started in that, we found out that our prayers actually worked and they were supposed to do something. And people would come and knock on our door that we didn't even know. And they'd heard that when we prayed, they got answers. And I'm not boasting on us, I'm boasting on God. But I'm saying you and I should have such a place for God in our home that people seek you out because they know that God works through you. Amen. Those that believe and will be baptized, these signs will follow them. Amen. In my name, they will cast out demons. They will speak with new tongues. They will take up serpents. That don't mean you got to go run around grabbing snakes. But it means like if you're in Paul in the Bible and you're on the island and a snake bites you, you don't go, oh, I'm going to die. You just slap the thing off and move on. Y'all out there? And so verse 19 says, so then after the Lord had spoken to them, he was received up into heaven and sat down at the right hand of God. And they went out and preached everywhere. What happened after they got baptized? They went out and preached everywhere the good news of the gospel, sharing the life of Christ with people. Amen. And went out and confirming the and the Lord working with them and confirming the word through the accompanying signs. Amen. And so Mark could have said, he who believes with saving faith or faith that produces action, these signs will follow. Amen. And then they went out and preached, praise God. John chapter 3, verse 16. says this. It says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever..." Man, yeah, you get around a lot of people and they're thinking, "Man, if I could just get good enough to get to church. When I get good enough, I'll go to church." You need to let people know you can't get good enough to get to church. If you could get good enough on your own, you wouldn't need Jesus. We need Jesus. Amen. They need to come as they are. And we need to not judge them. We need to bring them in so that they can receive Jesus and then get a life change. Amen. I've got a friend from my Bible school, and he was in prison for murdering a cop. And while he was in jail, in prison, he started reading Brother Hagin's books, got a hold of some of Brother Hagin's books, and got saved, gave his life to Jesus, and he was never supposed to get out of prison. He started believing God. And they gave him a parole, an interview for parole, and then they paroled him. And he's been out preaching the gospel for the last 25 years. God can do anything if your heart is right. If you want to serve God, God will fix anything. Amen. If you just want to play around, well, have fun. Amen. But that's about all you'll have is worldly fun. Amen. And so, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world." Hello? It's not your job to condemn everybody. Amen. Jesus didn't even come to condemn everybody. It's not our job to condemn them. It's our job to love them, bring them, get them into the kingdom, and let God work on them. I don't know about you, but I'm glad he didn't condemn me. I remember we were in Klamath Falls, and I'd just gotten saved, filled with the Holy Ghost. I smoked 3 packs of cigarettes a day, drank a half a case of beer, and cussed. I could have taught the sailors how to cuss. And looked at the girls. And I was married. And this little old ladies at the church, they heard that I'd gotten filled with the Holy Ghost, and I was still smoking. And they used to bring me gum on Sunday to chew instead of smoke cigarettes. Yeah, it might sound simple, but the fact that they cared enough about me just to bring something and try and help me helped me to grow. Instead of them coming up, "Well, you need to quit that smoking, you stink," I'd have smacked them and kept smoking. Y'all out there? People don't need to be smacked. And they don't need to be told what they're doing. I mean, you don't have to yell at a guy in a hole and say, "Hey, stupid, you're in a hole." He knows he's in a hole. What you need to do is throw a rope, put a ladder down, help them get out. They've had enough of being crushed. That's why they act that way. They're used to being crushed. They're used to being not accepted. They're used to being disliked. Jesus loves them. Our job isn't to condemn them. Our job is to help them find Jesus. Amen. It says, verse 18, "Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the Son, the only Son of God." And so if a person does not believe, he's condemned, even if he's been water baptized. And I say that because a lot of people, they had their kids sprinkled when they were babies, thinking somehow religiously that this was going to protect their kids for eternity. But water baptism is something you do after you make a decision for Christ. You don't get baptized in water with no decision for Christ and then become saved. You become saved by making a decision for Jesus. And then after you make that decision, then you get baptized. Acts chapter 2, verse 41 says, "Then those who gladly received the word," and received the word means that they accepted Christ, they accepted the word that was preached. And he says, "Those who gladly received his word were baptized." In other words, they got baptized after they received the word, after they responded to the word and accepted Jesus Christ. And I know there's a lot of people, they got their kids baptized when they were young, and they think, well, they're, you know, I got them baptized. Well, that doesn't mean anything. They have to come to an age where they can make a choice for Jesus or not for Jesus. And when you come to that age, whatever it is, it could be between 10 or 13 or somewhere in there, and you make a decision, am I going to follow Christ? But how many people haven't heard of Christ? Or how many have had him presented in a wrong way who are not going to receive just because of the Christians they've met? I don't know about you. I've met, when I was unsaved, one of the big reasons I didn't even go to church or anything is because of the Christians. Most of them are so mean and picky, stupid. Just saying, you know. It's almost unusual to meet a nice Christian. Acts chapter 10. I like this section. Acts chapter 10, verse 44. This is a section where Cornelius, if you've read the Bible, how many are y'all reading your Bible? If you go to this church, you better be reading your Bible. Don't be coming to church and never read your Bible, because you're in bad shape. But in Acts chapter 10, there's a story of Cornelius, who is just, he's just a Gentile. He's a non-Jew, but he's been seeking after God. But because he's not a Jew, he doesn't know all the everything there is, but he's heard about Jesus, and he's got a group of people with him, and they're seeking God, and they're trying to find out what they can find out about this Jesus and about God and everything. And evidently, he's got a pretty good-sized group with him, a big home meeting. And while he's praying, two angels show up and tell him to send some guys over and get Peter the apostle and have him come and tell them about Jesus, because you can't get saved until you've heard the word, until you know what God has to say. And so he sends some guys over to get Peter. Peter's on the top of a roof, and he's having a trance, and sheets are coming down with all kind of animals in them that the Jews aren't supposed to eat. And God says to him, eat the animals. And Peter's like, dude, I can't eat those. You told us we're not supposed to eat them. And what God was trying to do was let him know that we're going to open the gospel to the Gentiles and everybody. Amen. Not to Jews only, but everybody. Salvation's for everybody. And so Peter goes to Cornelius' house to tell them about Jesus. And verse 44 says, while Peter was still saying these things, the Holy Spirit fell on all who heard the word. And when you read that, heard the word, that means they were excited about it. Cornelius and these guys had been seeking God. They were hungry for the things of God. They didn't know exactly what it all meant, but they were hungry for it. How many know you need to be hungry for God? You know, you and I need to stir up every once in a while. If we get cold, we have a tendency as people to get excited one day and then bored the next 40 years. And you and I need to stay stirred up, the things of God. And they were hungry for that word. When they heard it, man, they were like, yeah, that's what we've been waiting for. Because it was life to them. It says in the believers, the Holy Spirit fell on all who heard the word, and the believers from among the circumcised who had come with Peter were amazed, because the gift of the Holy Spirit was poured out even on the Gentiles, for they were hearing them speak in tongues and extolling God. Then Peter declared, can anyone withhold water for baptizing these people who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have? And Peter's like, man, I don't know what happened here, but these guys got the same gift from God that we got. They need to get water baptized. And I'm saying that because that the water baptism is the first thing you're supposed to do after you get born again, as an outward sign of an inward work, and because Jesus said to do it. Amen. And as we water baptize, you know, we're identifying with Christ. When we dunk these people, you know, in the natural it might just look like dunking, but spiritually it's a signification of we are dying with Christ to the old self. The old man's dead as far as God's concerned. Why you keep trying to resurrect him, I don't know. But then as we lift up, this represents us being living Christ's on the world, on the earth. We're just like him. We're supposed to be. Amen. And so as we baptize, we're supposed to leave the old stuff we had, and then get into the Word, get into prayer, get into church, and start renewing our minds and dealing with our flesh, and become who Christ wanted us to be. Amen. Acts chapter 2, verse 36 says this. It says, "Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. Now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, 'Men and brethren, what shall we do?'" Evidently, they felt bad about crucifying Jesus. "Then Peter said to them," watch this, "'Repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit.'" Repentance is the first step, and it means to turn away from. When you received Christ, you were supposed to have repented of all your sins, say, "God, forgive me and accept me, receive me." And to repent means to turn away from that lifestyle and not go back. But I watch a lot of Christians, and they get saved and they repent and they turn away for a little while, and then the next thing you know, they're back at it again. But God wants us saved for our whole life. He wants us turning from the sin the rest of our life, not just for a couple of weeks. He wants us to serve Him with our whole heart all the rest of our days. And you guys, part of coming to church is just hooking up with people that believe the same thing or going the same direction and can help you all, help us all be accountable and stay straight. I don't know about you. I don't like sin. I don't want to sin. But every once in a while, if I'm driving behind somebody, tell me the truth. Are there two colors of green? Because I don't see them, but evidently somebody does. And sometimes I'll get a little, I have to repent. Can I get all of you to come up here? The baptizees, come on up here. Come on up here. I want you all just to stand up, stretch your hands out towards them. We're going to pray for them. Come on, right over here, right over here. Just right over here, right over here. You're not preaching. Stay down there. Turn and face me. Don't look at them. It'll make you nervous. Just bunch up. Just bunch up. Just bunch up. Get close. Get close. So stretch your hands out this way. Father, we just lift up these that are being about to be water baptized. And Father, we thank you that you live in them and that you live big in them. And Father, we pray that they will honor you with their lives all the days of their life. And Father, that their lives will be changed, their minds will be renewed. And Father God, that we're sending these people out into the world, anointed by your Spirit, anointed by the Holy Ghost. And Father, that they will never be the same again. But they are your ambassadors, sent into this world to do your work. And Father, I bless them, and I thank you for them. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, guys, if you can go that way, Aaron's going to show you how to go. Amen.
Jesus has changed my life so much. He delivered me from drugs and alcohol. And I'm so happy that I'm here in Oregon, because it took me so many years to come here, and so many prayers from not only my family, but pastors. And sorry. I'm just happy that I decided to do this, because my life is so much different than it should have been. And I'm sorry. I just love Jesus.
You know, Nellie's one of those people who has had a life change since receiving Christ, and it just blesses me a lot. Could you all hear her?
Yeah.
Praise God. Nellie?
Yes.
Obviously, you've received Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior.
Yes.
So upon your profession of faith in Christ, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, of the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Come on, amen.
Amen. God save all.
God.
Thank you, sweetheart. It's always great to see lives that have been changed.
My name's Sasha.
And have you had any changes, anything good happened since Jesus?
I found Jesus about 10 years ago, but I'm willful, and it took me a long time to listen to him. And once you listen to him, your life really does change.
So you've made Jesus Christ your personal Lord and Savior?
Yes, Pastor.
Upon that profession of faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Woo-hoo! Good job, Sasha.
Good job. Were you able to get a good enough picture? Come on, JoJo.
JoJo's awesome.
JoJo?
Yeah.
Have you got anything you'd like to say?
I would like to say that at this point in my life, I'm just hungry for God, and I'm ready for a change in my life, and I just can't wait to live a life with Christ.
That's awesome.
So you've made Jesus Christ your personal Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Upon your profession of faith in Jesus Christ, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, of the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Good job.
Have no swimming up here.
Grandkids.
What is your name?
Leslie Schmidt.
And have you had any changes in your life since you received Jesus?
Well,
has it been good?
I found Jesus about 25 years ago.
Yeah.
But it's time for this because I've got things to do.
Awesome. Amen. Amen. I'm proud of you.
Thank you.
Praise God. So Jesus is your personal Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Upon that profession of faith in Christ, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Awesome. Good job. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Hello.
You're a newbie.
I am a newbie.
What's your name?
Irma.
And anything exciting since Jesus?
Yes, lots of new exciting things. And I would like to declare in front of everyone that I am a new creation in Christ Jesus.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
That's
Amen.
Awesome.
Well,
just a little bit.
Yeah. Assume the position.
Okay.
Upon your profession of Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
God.
Amen. Amen. Over, are you going this time?
Yeah.
Worm. It's nice in here.
It's the movie boy.
Never. Oh, am I supposed to talk right now? Is that my voice? I'm sorry you guys have to listen to that.
You don't have to go so close.
Okay. Sorry.
Keep it under.
Okay, yeah. I just want to say thank you all for being here. There's a lot of important people here. When I started coming to this church, God put some really amazing people in my life that helped me grow. My jiu-jitsu coach is here today. Pastor Nate here, Pastor Rod, everybody. You guys are awesome. If you're close to me, you've probably heard me say this, but I came back to Oregon in 2014, but I really didn't come home until last year. So let's do this.
Upon your profession of Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Awesome. That's awesome.
there anything you'd like to say? Hang on just a second. If a family would like to take pictures, you can come up, but just stay out of the way. Okay, anything you'd like to say, sweetie?
I'm just excited to show my church family how much I love God.
Amen. That's good. That's good. So let me ask you a question. Have you made Jesus Christ your personal Lord and Savior?
Yes.
All right, sweetie. Come on back down here. We'll go. Okay. Other hand. Okay. Upon your profession of faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, of the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
You gotta smell at your mama.
All right, precious.
Job.
Good job. That's good because I haven't had a bath for a week.
Oh no.
Okay, what's your name?
My name is Rebecca, and I just want to thank my family for being here and taking part in this with me. I'm just really excited, and I want to thank God for loving me and accepting me for my flaws and all.
Amen. 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 So you've accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Upon your profession of Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
My name is Debbie. I just want to thank my daughter, Nicole, for being such a big influence on my decision to recommit my life to Christ. I am so ready and excited.
Awesome. Amen. 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 So, have you received Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior?
Yes.
All right. Upon your profession of Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son,
that's awesome. Congratulations. Awesome. Good job. Good job.
There you go. And your name?
Karen.
If you have anything to say?
Just really excited. I'm really ready to be free. I think that for a long time, I've known who God and Jesus are, but I've never really known. And I'm ready to just let go of everything and live my life for Him.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Awesome.
So, is Jesus Christ your personal Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Upon your profession of Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
That's awesome.
You're not going to freeze.
It's like a hot tub.
Anything you'd like to say?
I just want to thank God for everything He's done in my life and my wife's life, especially this year. A lot of things have been happening, and I think it was time to put the old man to rest and get reborn.
Come on.
Man, that's awesome.
So you've made Jesus your personal Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Upon your profession of Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Good job, man. That's awesome. Thank you. Congratulations.
Good job. Aren't they doing good?
I was talking to my friends this morning in the car on the way here, and God has been here so long for me. All my life, He's been there, faithful, pulling me back from the edge. Every time I'm about to jump, He's there. And He's never broken His promises, and it's time I start keeping mine.
ever will.
It's time I learned from him.
Amen. Is Jesus Christ your personal Lord and Savior?
More than once.
Amen. Upon your profession of Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
That's awesome. Good job. High five.
Odra is coming next. Most of you know her. And I was talking to her, and she's getting rebaptized because the first time she got baptized, it was just kind of with everybody else because she was in church, and that's what everybody's doing, so you get baptized. And then she was thinking about this. Did you want to say that?
Okay. Like Pastor said, I was one of those kids that grew up around church and accepted Christ before I was 10 years old, baptized when I was around 12 years old, and I didn't really live life and understood the difference between living for God and not living for God until later on. So my late teenage years, early 20s, life was a mess. And it isn't until now that I'm walking as much as I can to follow Jesus and understanding what the Father is, what the Son is, what the Holy Spirit is. And so a couple of years ago, I had a check in my heart to do this as an action of obedience. And I thought, I rationalized it. No, I've been forgiven. I already did this. I don't need to. And then it happened again last year, and I still didn't do it. Mainly to get up here and do this. I was avoiding that. But really is the understanding, the symbol of being submerged in the water and leaving the dead man behind, and understanding that and knowing that Jesus himself did that as an act of obedience, and that's what I want for my life. I want to be obedient, and that's why I'm here.
That's awesome. That's awesome. You did better than I did. That's awesome. She is a real blessing, and she's done a lot. Okay. Is Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior?
Yes, sir.
All right. Upon your profession of Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
That's awesome. Good job.
Well, praise God. That takes care of that. Thank you all for coming. And we'll see you next week. God bless you. Hope you all come back. Have a great week. What? Dismiss the kids.